Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our Ladies Study Group Plus Happiness Forum webinar, which we have exclusively curated for all of you in the lockdown. Each of us knows someone who is experimenting with or flaunting their culinary skills during this extended lockdown. From millennials to Gen Z, from boomers to their seniors, people across ages and geographical boundaries are picking up the ladle or the karchi, either for the first time in their life or for the first time in a very long time. The lockdown-led cooking universe has several worlds running parallel. In one, there is pasta and fried. Another has a surfeit of banana bread, baked and fried. In some, leftovers rule. Yet others are going back to their roots. And social media platforms like Facebook and Instagram are overflowing with such food images, recipes, menu ideas, and cooking tips. Cooking has truly become a therapeutic medium for each and every one of us. And so I felt this subject was the perfect choice for our Happiness Forum session. And I'm so honored to have the very best ambassador for both food and happiness with us today. I'm so delighted to bring you all Asma Khan, who is joining us all the way from London this afternoon. Welcome to Ladies Study Group, Asma.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me.
It's our pleasure and we're so excited. Asma Khan's journey is the kind of story arc that most novels or Hollywood blockbusters would aspire to be. Asma has been an advertising executive, a journalist, a law student, and is now a wildly successful chef. Her kitchen consists entirely of women, and she's taken traditional family recipes and brought them to an international audience. She has gone from hosting a supper club to opening her own restaurant. She is the first British chef to be chosen by Netflix to be on volume 6 of Chef's Table, spotlighting her London restaurant, Darjeeling Express. The series was nominated for an Emmy in the Outstanding Documentary section. She is known for her dishes that reflect her heritage, and I'm so happy that she is with us today. Before we move on, I would request all of you to activate your mute button so that you can enjoy what Asma is going to be saying to us. We will have a question and answer session later, and you can unmute yourself as and when you would like to say something to Asma. Also, do use your speaker view setting on your Zoom gadget for better viewing of this event today. So Asma, tell us about your journey and tell us, I know you have very strong roots in Calcutta. I can't say the word Kolkata, and I know so do you struggle with that. So tell us about your journey from Calcutta to England.
It's somehow a strange thing that, you know, I still sometimes wake up thinking I have not left Calcutta. And this is really to do with, you know, that city doesn't leave you. You can leave the city. But that city is something that you carry with you forever. But I want to introduce two of my chefs. This is Asha. This is Rashmi. Asha is from Darjeeling originally, and Rashmi is from Bombay. So they're going to be assisting me. So let me continue. And Asha actually speaks better Bengali than me.
Let me welcome them too. Asma, let me welcome them too. Welcome Asha and welcome Rashmi. We're so excited to have you.
Thank you.
They're so excited because they never want to come on any Zoom, anything that Zoom cook along. They're always the background. I said no. I want this to be because it actually our story is so unique, and I also want, you know, people over here are surprised. But you know, even in India, you do not have an all female kitchen where you have, you know, housewives who are cooking. And I think that, you know, I just wanted them to see that, you know, this is how it is. Acha, I'm just going to tell you, we'll cook after 15 minutes. We'll cook after 15 minutes, okay? So, yeah, the journey from Calcutta, I had an arranged marriage. In my family, people tend to get married very early. And, you know, your marriage is kind of arranged and people talk about your marriage from a very young age. Unfortunately for me, there was no one suitable. There was no suitable boy. And I went to college and everyone was panicking about what was going to happen to me. And there was a man who wanted to marry me who was teaching at Cambridge. And I think within 3 months of meeting, I joined him in Cambridge. So very, very traditional arranged marriage. I spent the 3 months that I had between my meeting him and our marriage being fixed and going to Cambridge to join him in making gararas, going to Hyderabad, having this earring I wore, because I just thought people might recognize this Hyderabadi earring. I had all my jewelry made, matched to my outfits, and I had matching shoes made. And
you were in Kolkata before this, is it?
Yeah. And the thing is that, you know, it was, and I was excited to leave, you know, and get married. I didn't realize the enormity of leaving Calcutta and leaving family. It really hit me when I moved to Cambridge, where, you know, I suddenly realized that I was alone. And this is, of course, you know, very hard for people now, especially look at what we're doing. I'm cooking in my kitchen in the heart of Soho in London, and everyone is watching in their homes in Calcutta. But when I left Calcutta, we didn't even have, we only had Doordarshan, and there was no technology. I wrote letters to my parents, and I am, you know, I lived briefly in Hyderabad and Madras, but Calcutta is for me home. I was born there, and even now, if I'm walking anywhere in London, someone touches me and say, "Tumar bari koi," I will say Calcutta, because there's something that is there inside me, which I always feel I belong to Calcutta. And there's no kind of, it's very hard to explain to people who haven't actually grown up with Calcutta what it means. And I am everything I am because of being from Calcutta. So my family, my brother is still in Calcutta. I hope he's watching. Hi, Arif, if you're watching. And I have relatives there. My parents, 2 years ago, moved to Aligarh, where my father's from. My father's Rajput. And, you know, eventually wanted to move. My mother, who has left Calcutta and gone to Aligarh maybe 25 years ago, still pines for Calcutta. She's, you know, I think that this is something about the city that, you know, all of us who have left, our heart is still left in the city.
Very true. Very true. Yes. So then you moved to Cambridge, and then what happened?
So I moved to Cambridge and was living with a stranger, trying to get to know him. In my excitement of getting married and making my jodas and jewelry, I kind of didn't learn how to cook. I didn't know how to cook. And he is very liberal, very, very, you know, very different from a lot of kind of people who I grew up watching, you know. So very chilled out person. He told my parents, "I don't believe in gender roles. I will cook for her." Didn't say that he is a very, very, very average cook. And only knows to make, he knows how to make one thing. And the rice, my God, the rice he used to make, I could glue myself on the ceiling. It was like sticky, sticky, sticky. Anyway, so yeah, so I got married to a man who was stranger to me, who cooked food that was hard for me to eat. And then he never ate a single meal with me, because he was at that year that we got married, he was an admissions tutor and graduate tutor at a Cambridge college. So he was like, you know, he takes his work very seriously, which, you know, I really admire about him. You know, why will you look after your brand new wife? You go and eat with your students. That's what he did. He went and ate in college, leaving me to eat that chicken curry for the whole week. It was tough. It was tough. I was desperately lonely. And, you know, I can't see the faces of everybody who's here, but those who are 50 and above will remember the time when you made international calls and you timed that call to the second. It took exactly 3 minutes. And so I used to talk to Ammu, and everybody was like, "Beta, hi, hi." No one gave me that space to ask, "Are you okay?" They never asked me that question. So Cambridge was very, very lonely. And I used to imagine, you know, that, you know, in the Quran, when they talk about hell, you know, being fire and, you know, all kinds of boiling oil in which you're put, I used to think, no, hell is Cambridge in January. The river had frozen, the trees were stripped of leaves. And, you know, it's so easy to forget that, you know, the time that I grew up in Bengal, and a lot of people remember, we didn't get exposure to the West as much if you didn't travel abroad. So I, you know, of course, I saw Love Story and I saw the snow and the trees without leaves. But the realization when you walk and you touch the bark of an absolutely raw, dry tree, you know, I at that time in Cambridge felt that the tree would never have a spring and I would never have a spring. I felt everything that was beautiful and soft and comforting had been stripped from me, like the tree, because leaving Calcutta and leaving home was that kind of feeling of just being, of being raw and exposed to that cold, biting wind, which it was just, you know, I still remember that first winter of mine in Cambridge, trying to learn how to cycle, trying to make friends with the stranger who had married, eating food that was hard to eat, and remembering every second what home felt like. And not being able to communicate this to my parents as well when they called, because I got the feeling they were so excited that I got married, I was married and living in Cambridge, that, you know, my mother would keep telling me, Beta, wear socks and sleep. Beta, are you feeling cold? But she never even gave me the time to say, Amma, I'm freezing, but not just the cold. I feel bereft of everything. And it was really tough. It was not easy. And, you know, and then, you know, I figured out that I better learn how to cook. Because when I cooked, you know, in that aromas of the khana, the masala, the biryani, the korma, the risala, the chaat, all those smells that came through in my kitchen permeated me. I felt the presence of my mother next to me almost. It was that going home. So food took me home. And this is why I cook. And this is why a lot of people ask me, you don't do fusion and you don't do, you know, modern Indian food. You don't do progressive Indian food. That is not why I cook. I cook to celebrate my roots. I cook to celebrate the heritage of a city that I'm carrying with me inside here. So why would I do all of this kind of modern? And it's great that people do it. You know, I have no problem with them doing it. But personally for me, you know, adding seaweed and you know, truffle oil to my food is sacrilege. I want to celebrate who I am. And I want to celebrate that I am the face of every woman who cooks in a house in India, who never has this professional space around you. You go to culinary school, you're trained through the Oberoi's and the Taj, and you then become a chef. And you know, that's really how a lot of girls have come up, and you find female chefs with a culinary history. But you know, the best education is the one that we learn at home. And the way that our mothers have taught us. And because they don't value themselves as good cooks, we also think this education that they're giving you is also has no value.
Very true. So how did you start then moving to the supper club concept? How did you develop that idea? That was your first step, but, right? The supper club?
Yeah, the supper clubs I did in my own house. I had no money, and you know, telling my husband, who was, you know, an academic, and you know, very keen that I actually teach law or set up a law firm, because I was helping a lot of women out who were suffering from domestic violence. It was very hard to tell him that I got a first in law school. You know, everyone thinks I should be doing this and that, and you know, I'm doing a PhD, which was something I really enjoyed doing. But it never excited me.
And you completed, right? For all our viewers. Asma, for all our viewers who just joined us, because we have people joining in all the time, I want to tell them that you have a PhD in law. I mean, so that's a very, very important detail, you know. So
yes, I did the PhD. I was interested in the subject, but to some extent, I did the PhD to impress my husband and my family, because the thing is that, you know, those who may know Amna, and Amna's friend is here, her name is Rajeshree. Hi, Rajeshree. Amna, you know, I'm surrounded by very beautiful girls in my family. And this is always a problem that, you know, you are the smart one, they're the pretty one. They're the fair ones, you're the dark one. All of this was to happen. So somewhere I internalized it that I'm the smart one. I'm the first girl in the family to get a PhD. And, you know, even though I didn't take the place, I was offered a place to study law at Cambridge, you know, which is a huge thing. And it was all these things that I thought this would make everybody very proud of who I am. But at some point I realized that there is a voice inside me which says, oh, all of this does not matter. What matters is what I cannot, you know, the excitement of not cooking. I mean, it is a feeding. I just loved seeing someone else eat the food I cooked. Because I remember what it was like for me when I pined for the food of home. And that feeling that I could actually, so whoever cross that person is bearing that I cannot see, but I have through my food embraced them, and it gave me pleasure. And no amount of money, and I would have been very rich if I'd stayed on as a lawyer, no amount of money and no amount of victory of a court case would give me the thrill that I saw when someone ate biryani I made. And it was very hard for someone who's not a cook, like my husband, to even understand that I had a dream. And it was a dream that kept me awake at night. That I dreamt of becoming something, of creating a kind of network, getting other women. Because, you know, I always felt I was lucky that I could break my chains of patriarchy, of, you know, of the kind of society that, you know, was, I'm talking about 30 years ago. I don't think it's changed that much, especially not in the villages. This attitude towards gender, towards girls. True. I wanted to do something that celebrated everything that I am, not just me. I am the face of every woman who never got uploaded. I am the face of every dark-skinned girl in a family who's seen as not as good as the others. I am the face of every lamented birth of a girl because it wasn't a boy. So I wanted to be able, I needed a platform. I needed to become something so I could raise these issues. I mean, I never imagined I would be on Netflix, of course. And but yes, I use food as a conversation. And, you know, this is something very specific to UK. You know, I tell people this, you cannot take my food if you do not take me. In America, they don't want the Mexicans, but they eat tacos. So in the same way, in this country, you cannot be racist. You cannot be Islamophobic. You cannot mock people who look like me, who have a name like me, and ridicule us, but yet you want to eat my food. You can't. You need to sit down on the table. Let me feed you with honor and respect. The Indian tradition of how we look after guests. Let me actually serve you. Let me sit down and talk to you and tell you who I am, why this food is so important. Our food is part of our DNA. You need to accept that. If you get up from the table and you hate me, I forgive you. That's part of my faith. I must forgive you for hating me. I will not hate you. But you need to take my food with me, with everything of my culture. You have no right to wear my clothes. You have no right to take chana masala and call it some kind of crazy stew. You have no right to cook my food. Sorry, this is the fire alarm, which is just a test. I have this fire too.
Okay. Okay, good.
This happens all the time. Asha, what do you think? Sorry, I just have a slide, but we can continue to talk.
No. Yes, of course. All good, right?
So I, for me, food was really about a way of communicating, of identifying myself. Just one minute. What happened? Okay. So I did the supper clubs as a way of, you know, doing it behind my husband's back to some extent, because, you know, I didn't even know how to explain to him. I thought he's not there, he'll never know. It's fine. No damage is done. And I started supper clubs in my house where I started making biryani, chicken chop, cooking the food of Calcutta, not just Calcutta Mughlai food, I did Bengali food. Because of course, you know, if you're not from Calcutta, you don't understand this. Calcutta has a myriad of cuisines, you know, from Marwari to, you know, to Bengali, yeah. Then you have the Bihari tradition, and then you have the Mughlai tradition, and then you have Indo-Chinese. So, you know, the lovely food of Tangra, I did all of that. So as you know, the Tangra Supper Club, what was so beautiful in the Tangra Supper Club is that a lot of older Chinese, you know, grandmothers came who left after the 62 internment of the Chinese during the Indo-Chinese War. And they would sit there and weep and sing songs, remembering Calcutta. So my house became a home for everybody who left. And, you know, to some extent, this is, you know, as a voice of an immigrant, but maybe some of you can relate to this. Then, you know, the first home we live in, which is really truly ours, is the womb of our mother. After that, everyone is a migrant. So when people tell me, oh, you're an immigrant, you're a migrant, I turn around and say, you know, where is your mother? Where's the home you were born in? Where's the country you were born in? You'd call me an immigrant and a migrant because of the color of my skin and my accent. But when we leave the womb of our mother, home is always somewhere else. We move forward. We get married, we move for education, we move all the things. So, yeah, so the supper club became a gathering of people to break bread in the biblical sense as well, you know, about peace, but also about this kind of common experience together.
So you also feel very strongly, I know, about the second, being the second daughter. And you, yeah. So can you tell us a little more about that?
Well, the thing is that, you know, ironically, my mother has treated my brother and me and my older sister absolutely equally. Her disappointment was just the initial birth, but that is, you know, my mother was 19 when she had me. Society kind of told her, your family will not be complete till you have a boy. But my father was completely unbothered, but that was the color of boy. My father's a rock star. But, you know, and then when my brother was born, my mother didn't even celebrate his birth. And I remember neighbors telling us that if you have a sister, I said, no, I had a brother. So she didn't distribute laddus, she did nothing. This was really, at a very young age, I was only 3.5 when Arif was born, but I understood this one thing, that my mother, herself born of 5 daughters, had a real understanding about what it meant to make everyone feel equal. But then I suddenly became aware of how around me there was this discrimination and people telling when they saw 2 girls or 3 girls saying, when will your family be complete? And the kind of, you know, celebration when a boy is born, the lamenting when a girl was born, this whole idea that, you know, it's a responsibility. The dowry system is a nightmare. And the problem is, yeah, you cannot even blame the family that is middle class, lower middle class, who feel the burden of a girl and who worry about, you know, protecting her honor, getting her married. We're a society which, you know, and I, when I said it, I realized that, you know, I am not criticizing my mother. She's incredible. She treated me the same that she would have treated if she had had a boy. She was disappointed when I was born because everybody made her feel she had failed by delivering me. And I had that sense, that feeling that, you know, I used to dream, when I used to go out and people used to tell my father that Nawabsa bus, like, this is all you have. I used to dream my name in lights. Asma Khan, wow, in lights. I never changed my name in my marriage because it had to be Asma Khan. Not just Asma Khan, Asma Sayyid Khan. Because I wanted to show to everybody, not my own family, my mother and father, you know, incredibly, you know, I mean, progressive people, deeply spiritual, and yet, you know, understanding, you know, aspirations. You know, if I told my mother, you know, I want to be a pole dancer, she'd say, ha ha, beta kar do. She's not, it was incredible. She's not at all judgmental. You know, she's just really, she just wanted to celebrate because it didn't happen with her.
Yeah. I believe you never wore pink till you were 45 years old because of the same reason. Is that true?
Yeah, and at this, I became a tomboy completely to try and prove to my family that I was like a boy. And it became very hard to stop that when my brother was born. So I continued. I never wore pink. I never had a doll. I don't know, there's a lot of people here who are watching who would know that I played cricket with them on the streets of Calcutta. And I would also fight with them and hit them with the bat. So, you know, I was just one of the boys. I played with Arif, who was a great cricketer, my brother, and his friends. I played on the streets of Bright Street, and I thought I was not a girl. I never wore pink. When I told my son this, he cried. I was 45. He told me, no, mama, you're a girl. You're a mother. You must wear pink. I felt that was letting, I don't know who down, because not my mother. But, you know, society is a terrible thing. It permeates through your skin and gets into your soul and crushes what is inside. And that's what Indian society is when it comes to girls.
You know, Asma, hearing you, it's mesmerizing. And I don't feel like telling you to start doing some cooking, but we want to see that too. So I think maybe we could talk
and I would have to start cooking together.
So the thing is that I just realized.
So
we start simultaneously
today is Eid. Together. Today is Eid in London. So Eid Mubarak. So I'm doing it slightly Thank you. So I'm doing it the slightly other way around because we should start.
Yes.
So I'm making shahi pata. And I have given Diya. Diya might not give you all, but you better hear from her. All 4 recipes are what I'm cooking. So Diya has in her hand the entire recipes of how to do. So I'm making shahi tukra, but what I want to show is that, you know, people often, so saffron is, you know, something that everyone uses quite a lot, but the important thing is that you bas thoda sa garam karna is to bring the saffron back to life. So don't toast it, don't crush it, don't mash it. So I'm just going to show you just thoda sa rashmi bas. Yeah. So I'm going to show you what happens. You just want the, so this is, yeah, this is right. So this is milk, but it is blood temperature. It's not too hot, not too cold. This is like the Goldilocks rule, huh? Not too hot, not too cold. And then I put the saffron in, and you can see from there that it slowly, 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 it will start changing color. And it allows it to soften, because the thing is that, you know, the saffron has been, now I'm adding it to the milk that I've been cooking. The saffron has been dried out in the sun, so it needs to have a very gentle thickening. So all the aromas and the flavors and the color. So obviously you can't smell, but it's this kind of floral softness. And of course, you know, we are very lucky in London that we can get any kind of saffron. I do try to use, if I can, Kashmiri saffron. It's quite hard to get, very good quality saffron. Mm-hmm. This one is from Iran. The Spanish saffron is, I hope there aren't many Spanish people watching, is second quality. But, you know, saffron is a very expensive ingredient, and it's better to use less, but use something less metallic, you know, that doesn't have that horrible chemical smell and taste. I'm sure some of you can relate to this. You know the saffron is not good. It has that chemical smell. But it could also be that you haven't been able to bring it to life properly. So that's one of the tips, is that you'll find that in the recipe, which I'll share with you, is how to bring the saffron back to life, to treat it very gently. And, you know, I know people often say that saffron is the most expensive ingredient in the world. Yeah. But I'll tell you what is more expensive than saffron, which is your time. When you cook, honor yourself. You have the right to be respected. Because this time that I am spending cooking, I will never be able to buy back. I can buy every saffron in the world. You know, the problem is when we cook, we don't even, because it is so part of patriarchy, the way that women serve food, that we don't even know that this is my right to be honored. These are my hands with which I cooked. I'm giving you part of myself. I'm giving you something invaluable that I'll never get back. Okay, so what Asha has done is she has, I'll show it to you before I dunk it in. So she has fried each, like a kind of French toast, each like piece of bread. Don't worry about it too much. All the recipe is there. She's fried it in ghee and oil. You need to have that combination, otherwise it gets too smoky. And then I've dunked it in this milk, which has got sugar and saffron and everything, and cardamom. And then I'm going to take it out, and I'm going to put it on a plate. And then, of course, I'll pour more milk on it. I'm going to finish it. So this is, I'm just doing four, because otherwise I'd be here forever. So again, you know, just, again, like just, you don't want the, you want the, it's hot. Right, so it's going to absorb the milk very fast. If you talk on the phone, get distracted, have an argument with your mother-in-law, not a good idea to do all this. Really, really focus, okay? Because that bread will disintegrate in 2 seconds. Because it's, and don't try and use very fresh bread, huh? This is a bread which you need the bread to kind of hold. And I know people use sourdough and all of this, for God's sake, this is just normal sliced white bread, huh? You don't need to be fancy with this. So I'm putting all of this here. Of course, Asha will tell me that I didn't do it very as neatly as her. She is actually my boss, and everybody jokingly calls her my mother-in-law. My mother-in-law is so sweet. She doesn't make it. Asha, all the time. And the worst thing is that, you know, every day I come to work, she says, "You can't prop NK Aya." I say, like, you know, so my clothes, I have a set of clothes here that Asha approved, that she will make me change because I'm not well-dressed enough. So, yeah. Sauce of the great order, huh? I need a chamach. So I'm going to add, pour some of this milk, which I will try and show you without all the fish falling down. Can you see that there is that saffron in that milk? So I'm going to put the saffron.
Correct, yes.
The saffron milk on top. So, yeah. So on this, I'm just pouring some bit of extra milk for it to absorb. Okay. Now, what on it? So this, I know that's not, this is Cornish clotted cream. This is what you put on top of scones, okay? But I am using this instead of malai. Can I have another spoon? Yeah, so over here, so I'm going to use this where I would have used malai on top of the bread. I'm using clotted cream. And I know it sounds a bit of a sacrilege, but my God, the clotted cream is better than malai. There. So there it goes. You can see it slowly melting. Because normally we would put malai on this. So there, you can see.
Oh my God, it's amazing. Goes, amazing.
Yes, yes, yes. This is the best clotted cream in the whole place. And I'm putting some pista. And the thing is that, you know, please don't get hooked up about pista and badam and all of this. This is all people think they do this to impress people. It doesn't act. The best thing is actually the bread. So if you don't have pista badam, still make the chai dutra, okay? So it's, you know.
And the cream.
Yeah. So there. Can you see? That is my chai
dutra. Looks fantastic.
Now, because I've added something, I'm going to give it to Rashmi to put it in the fridge. You can have this warm. And then it's nice because it has still crispy ghee fried bread kind of thing. You can have it cold. But I would tell everybody, put it in the fridge, make it before your guests come. This is an inexpensive, really nice, very, very Shahi, traditional dessert to have. And as it was Eid, I made the meetha first. Eid Mubarak. I'll send that off. Okay,
thank
so now
you.
we move to the next thing that I'm making, which is the beetroot raga. Now in the beetroot raga, we're going to put, beetroot is something that, you know, in this country, people all just boil in vinegar. Goa people don't know how to have beetroot. So basically, I realized that, and you get the best kind of beetroot here. I tend to toss it over. This is my restaurant kitchen for 3 years. I still don't know how to chota karo and bada karo anything in this place. Not that I don't cook, but I always have Asha standing next to me. Also, she has this incredible thing. She always holds my stomach away from the flame. So yeah, she's like my mother-in-law. She's always worried that I'll catch fire. So she's always pushing my stomach and adjusting the flame. You need Ashas in your life. You need someone like that who, you know, The flame is so far away, but she'll hold you back. This is what women should do,
nice.
You know? You need to
Absolutely.
Surround yourself with that kind of women. Okay, so I want to show you something about Zira. Now, there's a huge difference between Zira as it is here, Sabat Zira, which is whole, and Buna Zira. Buna Zira is absolutely Zira on steroids. It is just, it pumps up your Zira to a different level. So, Because Zira burns very quickly, and if you're new to Bunaing Zira, a small quantity, I have a little trick for you, which is that you keep, obviously I'm only going to hold it in my hand because over here everything's too hot, hold my crap. But you keep the Zira that has not been punur in your eye view, because then you can actually see the change in the color. Otherwise, what will happen is, you think, is it black enough? Is it brown enough? Oh, suddenly the smoke is coming and it's got fire. So that point doesn't reach where it has overburned or become too burnt and you don't understand it. I need a spoon. So that's a spoon. This Zira, which I got here. Yeah. So I'm putting the Zira and you can hear it.
Yeah, the crackers.
So the thing is that, and now I can smell it, and it's so it's really, really quick. Can you see the smoke coming out of it?
Yeah,
the smoke coming out of it.
Yeah,
it's super quick. Yeah. And the thing is that, so there it's ready. Put it on a cool plate, spread it out, okay, and let it cool down.
Okay.
So then, when that Zira cools down, you crush it. You can crush it and then you can make the raita. So I'm going to show you how to make ye chula ban ho sakta mera aap log jata. Thank you. So now I'm going to show you how. So this is very, very thick. This is very thick yogurt. If you are dieting and you want to use low fat yogurt, then don't make this dish. Because what will happen is with the beetroot, it releases water the moment you put salt. And has this lovely bubblegum color. But if your dahi is very thin and panpaniya, it will become like water. It will look like lassi. You don't want raita to look like lassi. So cut the fat on something else. Huh? eat less cookies. Okay. But when you make beetroot raita, please, for God's sake, use super, super thick yogurt. Okay, so I'm going to add. So this is just raw beetroot, huh? Not cooked, not anything. So it's also for all these people who are actually trying to be healthy and finding ways to have beetroot, and all you do is visit in a juice or a smoothie. This is a much nicer way to have it. So I'm going to add some of the thing. Beetroot, I'm mixing it. So already you can see the pink color coming through.
Yeah.
And the thing is that, you know, so much of our food is so boring looking because it's all brown.
Beautiful color.
It's so nice. Yeah, but the thing is that, you know, we don't have things that are, you know, so when you go to a Mediterranean or an Italian meal, you know, everything is so bright and, you know, our food, unfortunately, not the case. Okay, so here, can you see the color? This is instantly.
Really bubblegum. Really bubblegum color.
Yeah. And it's a, so here is the Buna Zira, which has been crushed. So I'm adding the Buna Zira. So the difference between Buna Zira and freshly Buna Zira and normal Zira is, as we say, Aswan Zaminka. So do not, it takes 1 second, literally you saw, okay? Do it. Just crush it fresh. It just makes a huge difference. There's a little bit of chilies. I'm not adding so much because my one son doesn't want to eat too much chilies. Yeah. Okay, so it's just those. You'll find all the recipes in there. So there, I haven't mixed the masalas. You can see, I put zira, chilies, namak. I mix it up. And of course, you know, you can add more yogurt. The reason I haven't is because the bowl would have become too big. So obviously this, you know, you can add more yogurt. And so if you want, and I'll just add some garnish. Okay. Okay. So I'm just putting it up. So that's your beetroot raita, pink. Beautiful. If you leave it, pink. It gets more intense, closer to the color of the fresh red beetroot. It becomes more intense, but it doesn't become this. It gets more intense pink. So you know what, you have this kind of candy floss color. It'll be that candy floss color, that guy on the road who goes around. So it'll become that candy floss color. It's such a pretty, and actually very healthy dish to have on the side. The advantage is that, you know, beetroot will go with everything. And you know, everyone makes bundi ka raita or, you know, khira ka raita. This is a great raita to have. It's very unusual. And it's also, as you saw, very quick to make. Okay, so then I'm trying now to the last two things. Dia, you're going to kill me. I don't know whether I can't see the time because I'm like,
there's plenty of time.
I hope I'm doing okay.
Plenty of time.
Okay, fine.
Perfect.
Okay, otherwise you start telling me Asma, hurry up, huh? Say it. Because otherwise, no, I can talk forever.
The only problem is you've got all our mouths watering. Asma, you've got everybody's mouth watering now.
Okay, so now this is Rogi Roti. I want to show you what has gone into this. This is chakki atta, just normal atta, and little bit of bajra, chilies, and you have kissed onions. This is one of those very classic rotis from Bulandshahr. It's called Safar ki Roti or Rogni Tikya, Rogni Roti. This is, you know, because there are very few breads. I know Gujaratis have them. Whenever there are people who travel, there will be a bread that can travel cold. So when you look at the regions where you have breads that travel cold, see Punjabis now, they do their kheti and they figure out to have a tandoor and make tandoori roti. Good for them. Because they were staying put in their fields. But for the people like Gujaratis or people from UP and Bihar who had to move on and go out and look for work and became migrants, you know, who were working, they had to find a way of taking bread because they're not rice eating. You know, there's a huge divide in India between rice eating people and wheat eating. And our diets and our recipes and even the dal we make is dictated on what I'm doing this with rice, I'm doing this with roti. So anyway, so this is Rogi Roti, which Asha has. So this, she has stabbed it, okay? She's made stab marks on it. This is so that it doesn't pull off. What? Never. Huh? Is it such a much higher for the Rogi Roti? Okay, so where's the key? So I will make this in ghee. And you know, for those who are vegan, ghee go get. So this is ghee that we made at home. Because you know, bought out ghee is not nice in this country. So there I put some ghee. I put in the roti. So there is cooking. You don't have to worry that it has to be a tawa. And it's very, very quick. The thing is that in UP we have this for breakfast with aloo ka chutney, which is the aloo dish I'm going to be making next, or with masala omelette, or what we call khabina, which is masala scrambled eggs. You can cook this and let this to cool, and it becomes like a biscuit kind of thing, biscuit like. And I'm, you know, okay. People ask me, "Oh, you're an Indian food expert." I said, "Not at all. I don't even know all the food of Calcutta. Forget, you know, the world of India." So the thing is, I'm sure that there are versions of this roti everywhere, and I'm actually sure that there must be in Rajasthan as well. This kind of roti that you traveled with, that you made it, and you cooled it, it became this kind of roti. Yeah. So like, you know, bhatri is one of them, but you know, this is more like it's made with. So as this is what I'm very slowly it's cooking. And it will then, it's very nice hot, but strangely enough, it's very nice cold. Which is not the case with all our rotis, you know? Because many of our rotis, after it cools down, it becomes like a chappal. So it's rubbery. So and you because you made those stamp marks when you were putting it in, it doesn't actually fluff up. So it will stay. So there you can see it's staying flat and cooking very. And I'm cooking it very gently. Asha, I'm only going to make one, okay? Asha thinks I'm going to make three rotis. She's always setting my bar higher and higher. Already I'm cooking live. She made three rotis. I'm being never angry. Okay, here we go. Let's just make sure that the bar is on the Okay, so here. Is my roti doing really well?
Lovely.
Slightly flaked. Very, very, it's, you know, enriched with the ghee that's gone in and milk. So you'll find the recipe in there. Tweak around with it. I put bajra in it because I think that, you know, this is one of the things I'm trying to do. I'm trying to make my restaurant and my business more sustainable. Bajra is...
Asma, is it solid bajra or is it solid bajra or powder?
No, bajra. No, it's
the grain.
It's bajra ka pellets. Small ones. Yeah.
Grain.
Now, the reason I add bajra, and the reason I add bajra is a lot of people, this is our ancient grain. It has much more nutrients than wheat. Also, you know, it requires 1/4 the amount of water that wheat requires. It's much more resilient. Okay. It can deal with heat much more. The wheat mafia in places like UP, took over and almost, you know, farmers felt that, you know, I'm a wheat farmer. So it was seen as something being of pride. And all those farmers that used to grow bajra, in my life, I remember as a child running around bajra fields in Bulandshahr, where my father's from. Now everything is wheat. And I think that, you know, I don't want to be one of these kind of, you know, tree-hugging, crazy people who's talking about the environment all the time. But, you know, I will do my bit. I will reduce the carbon footprint on my own menu. So one of the things I do is that I try to substitute things that require less water, that, you know, are less harmful for the environment. And the biggest thing I do is I don't fly down any vegetables from India or Africa. Everything I use is British because I don't want the carbon footprint and the air miles on my menu. So I don't have okra on my menu or jackfruit on my menu. The beetroot is British. I use cauliflower, I use pumpkin, aloo, you know. And everything comes, and you know, what comes from Spain is my bengan and the herbs. And that's it. So I actually absolutely use everything local. I don't make a huge song and dance about it. I'm just telling people why I feel that, you know, even we can make small differences in our own lives. Because this is how, you know, drip by drip, you can have an entire river. And so I think I'm probably the only Indian restaurant that has no okra and no jackfruit and no pulled jackfruit and all of this. There's some things I have to bring from India, my masalas, and I have to bring my rice and my dals and chickpeas, kala chana. I use a lot of kala chana. But then I don't get anything that requires plastic packaging, air freighting, you know, chilled environment. That is really harmful. So, you know, I don't use any of that. So now I'm making aloo. The aloo is British, of course. So this is, the what I'm making is something called aloo ki katliya. Katliya is basically finely chopped aloo. Now this will cook super quick. But I know one thing, I learned this in India, that sometimes you have really bizarre aloo that takes forever. If that's happening to you and you have aloo that is not cooking, add a splash of water, cover it. I won't need to do this because I know this potato. This is British. It has very little water in it. It's going to cook very fast. And so it's going to only have two masalas in it. Very, very simple. I'm carrying the zira theme through. So the sabat zira and sukha lal mirch. This sukha lal mirch, it does come from India. And if you want it spicy, this is like super fiery. I must remember not to touch my eyes after I break it. But when you break it, this is what we make up. For those who might know my food from looking at my Instagram, this is the chilies we use for the tangra prawns. And in that tangra prawns, it's just chili and garlic that goes in. This is incredible chilies. And I have been through, and I'm not a huge chili person. I ate so much chilies, I suffered for days afterwards. But anyway, I ate all the chilies and I found the chili. And this is supplied just for me. Okay, so the thing goes in. Okay, and then the cheese, I break it, and the tomato garlic, Asha. Because obviously it's become too hot for me.
Yeah.
I don't want to spoil my nice food. Okay, and then mama? So, this is what it looks like.
Wow.
Don't add too much to it. In its own moisture, it will cook. Start rattling it a bit, I'm shaking it a bit. Whoa, the chili. Just stirring it gently. So, what you want in the end, you can put up on that it's cooked. You want it to look transparent, soft and transparent. So it's a very unusual, very beautiful visual dish. But it's just finished cooking, but that's the kind of potato I have got. So you know, and you know, it's not like this any risk of it. The other advantage of this is that no garlic, no onions, no chamela. If you don't have zira, you can use mustard seed, you can use fennel, salt, but really zira has a beautiful flavor and I love zira. So that's it. I managed to cook all four things that I said I would, and the recipe is out in the air.
Yes, amazing. And I'm going to share the recipe with all the members immediately after this event.
Extractor off. I'm putting the extractor off because now I stopped cooking. So then it's not going to be a lot easier to
Asma, all your restaurant has an open kitchen, right? So that the women could see your people eating and vice versa. What was the reason?
Yeah, and the thing is that, you know, this was very important for me because, you know, in our culture, in many families, the men and the boys eat first, the women who have cooked the food eat second. You never get to see the person cooking the food. And this is always, again, about the patriarchal structure of food in South Asia. Not just India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. You go to all these places, you know, the actual labor of the food is often not witnessed by the people who are eating the food. And I just feel that, you know, if you at least see the hands that are cooking, you may understand, you may respect and honor that person. And when you are served that food, you will look up and make eye contact with that person who you saw cooking your food. And this was very important for me. And, you know, you can't imagine, I had very little money when I was starting this restaurant. This extractor, I'm in the heart of Soho, It's Carnaby Street on the other side, where everybody thinks they live on the Ritz. So if they could smell Zira and Mirchi, there was one culprit only who they could come to, which is me. And I was a new person. I had to put the extractor, a huge metal pipe, above the highest building in Carnaby. But every money I had, I put into opening this gap that you can see there. So it's all open.
Yes.
That means this extractor has to work. The motor has to be incredibly powerful. And because it's very focused and controlled, what comes out is very strong in aroma. So I had to take it up. But I thought, you know, I will, inshallah, get money from somewhere. But if I also build a wall to save money, I will regret it at some point. Knowing the story that will happen, little knowing how my journey would go. But I had faith that I would be successful because I had to see my name in lights. And not just my
Absolutely.
Name. I had to see the name of each of these women. Because, you know, I remember our culture, you know, the lady who raised me, my brother and my sister and my mother, she was called Akbar ki Maa. She was the mother of Akbar. Just before she died, the last trip I made to Calcutta, I asked her, "Tumhara naam kya hai?" She told me, "Mera naam Tamila hai." She had a name, but everybody called her Akbar ki Maa. And the thing is that in so many cultures, especially in Bihar and rural Bengal, you suddenly lose even your name as the carer, the giver, the mother. And it just, you know, I just wanted them to be celebrated. And when I told the Netflix producer this, that, you know, for me, this was the kind of thing that I wanted. He never told me he would write the names of all the women against the wall. We had just gone through this horrible scene where you think it's effortless, no? All the food being put down in the last scene. We had to do 25 takes of that. Because you think anybody, they were like, 1, 2, 3, abhi dale. We all have to put it at the same time because they were filming on our head. And it was just took us 25 takes. Otherwise, everything else was without, you know, because they didn't script me. I just spoke. Everything, nothing was redone. But that shot killed us. So then they said, everybody stand next to the wall, we'll take stills of you. So the relief and the pride and the joy you see in these women's eyes is real because they had just done 25 shots. Of course, I don't think I was going to do this. They had done 25 takes of putting that bloody pole down, which, you know, we couldn't coordinate. There were like 8 of us. And, you know, and also 8 of us were being told that we can't talk, they can't talk. And they said, 1, 2, 3. And, you know, it's just like 1, 2, 3, you put it down. No, 1 centimeter this side. You have to put it down exactly there. Can you mark it? No, we can't mark the table. So in your mind, you have to know exactly where your ball has to go because they have the cameras above.
Correct.
So this was the thing that, I am not, you know, it's, you know, coming from India, where I would never have even sat and had chai with these women. They come from a very different background from me. I celebrate humanity. I celebrate the true Indianness of compassion and empathy. Because in my kitchen are three people who are pure vegetarians. They work with me, they work alongside me. And we celebrate, you know, every festival, Diwali, Eid, Rakhi, we are, for us, every barrier has come down because we suddenly, you know, home is not bricks and mortar. Home is an emotion. And for us, this is purely, truly our home. This, in this kitchen, we become the same. There are no differences. And, you know, for that reason, when I'm working in the kitchen, I get paid the same hourly rate as the person who washes the pots, as Asha, as Rashmi. I am the same as them. They know this because the wages are all paid openly. And you know, the fact that they know that I earn, and I don't keep any of the profits because the entire profits are given away to charity. I also help a lot of these women out. I don't keep the money. You know, I don't do this for money. The joy is in seeing how these women, you know, they grew in stature, in strength, in power, in who they were. And, you know, there's, you know, you can talk about, yes, I like to see women being uplifted. I want to have their empowerment. When you see 25 faces and you know how they started their journey, you can give me the wealth of the world. It will not make me so proud as seeing what these women are today. You know, they're rock stars and they're so confident. And yeah, so this has been an incredible opportunity for me to, because, you know, cutting my chains and being free would never have been good enough. I needed to know that I freed them too. Now I can celebrate.
So tell me, how did you celebrate your 50th birthday? I believe that was also very special. So can you tell me what you did on that?
I wanted to do something, you know, half century. I'm from Calcutta, Eden Gardens. Tamasha to hota hai na, taliya taliya. You need to do something dhamakedar for your 50th birthday. So I just, you know, one of the things I realized is that food can really make a difference to how women see themselves. It gives them self-respect. It gives them honor. The idea when they see other people eating, even if they don't say anything to them, that look in their eyes, you know that you have healed someone else. You may be broken inside, but watching that you're healing and feeding and nourishing, not feeding, you are nourishing someone else, empowers you. So I found out, you know, that there was this camp, refugee camp, where the Yazidi girls, as young as 12, had been picked up by ISIS men and used as sex slaves. Some of them had been sold repeatedly put in cages and sold like animals. And I, you know, after the defeat of ISIS, they had come into these refugee camps completely silent. They wouldn't talk, there was no joy, and they found it difficult to even talk to their elders and their loved ones of what had happened to them. And I think as part, their society is very much similar to us. No one wanted to know the details of what had happened to these girls. Nor did I. But I realized that, you know, I've done 50, I'm going to go and open a cafe. I'm going to use all my money. I made lots and lots of money last year because of Netflix. People came, spent a lot of money. I took all that money and I opened a cafe that was run by the Yazidi girls and to serve the Yazidi girls as well, young girls and communities. And it was very sweet. I went there to celebrate my 50th birthday and they made a cake for me. The oven I had already sent them in advance. I didn't understand now why, because they kept saying, can we get the oven in advance? Because they wanted to bake the cake when I arrived. And so now, you know, birthdays are celebrated, life is celebrated. They have a huge, you know, space in which to meet, a community healing space, a safe space. And it's a successful restaurant as well, because the Canadian government gives them all a small stipend. So after a while, I will not have to keep supporting them. They will finance themselves. It's an economic model. It can work. It can work in communities where there is some money and or where there are aid agencies willing to give families money to have a big meal. Because, you know, even understand our cuisine. If you are in a tent and you have a small chula, what can you cook? You can't make the biryanis or the big, you know, puris, things that, you know, you require space. You require a big karai to make it. So what this restaurant did is allowed families to pool their money together. And then they all cooked together and they had these huge salads, this big, you know, they made tabbouleh in a massive quantity. And when I was leaving, one of the girls, she told me, her story I know because she got given to the commander of the ISIS. And what he did to her, she couldn't speak for 3 years. And now she learned to speak again. She stammers. She's my head chef. And when I was leaving, she was clapping and bowing down to me. And she said in Arabic, one day I will be greater than you. She will. Wow. She will. And this is the thing that, you know, you give us, you light the fire inside the soul of a person. You know, never underestimate people who have been crushed, who have been ridiculed, who've been sidelined. That's a huge mistake. You go there and make them feel that they matter. Honor them. That's all you need to do. And it is very simple. Yes, you know, money is involved, but money comes second. Money always comes second. Empathy comes first. And, you know, my brother sent me a video yesterday. And, you know, this is the message from that video. I remember empathy and compassion comes first. And then comes, you know, success. Then comes money. Then comes everything else. Of course, you know, you do have business.
Of course. You know, I want to share with my members, Asma, that we didn't know each other till 2 weeks back. And when I was trying to connect with you, you were busy because you were doing Instagram videos with these young kids in Jaipur who wanted to become chefs. Can you tell us about that? I was so amazed.
Yes.
You had time for that also.
Yeah. No, I will always have time. I will always have time for this because if I don't do it, who will? If I don't stand by women, who want to break the shackles of where they are, who want to be free, who want to be Asha, who want to be Rashmi. I've seen their journey. I know where they came from. And I see them now as powerful women, as mentors, you know. So these girls, you know, someone contacted me through Instagram saying that, you know, they want to be chefs. One of their, there are these, you know, very sad families who've been hit so much by what's happened with the migrant laborers in Jaipur. Yeah. One's father's an electrician, the other one is a daily wager. Their dream is to bake cakes. Their dream is to become big chefs. And it was around my birthday. I spoke to them. I talked to them. I told them about, you know, what you learn in culinary school. You know, the biggest thing is you start small, but you always dream big. That dream has to be like, you know, as they say in South India, 70 yum yum. Huge screen. That is what you do. You dream the screen that big, but you start small. So I talked to them. And then they told me that they, it was my birthday a few days later, and they told me they'd make a cake, and they never used, of course, you know, they don't have an oven or anything. I was a bit concerned, you know, how they were going to make a cake. They made a cake with mud and coloring, and they made a cake with mud, with candles, and they wrote happy birthday, ma'am. And it was so beautiful. And, you know, and I could see in the details that they'd done, they had checked on pictures. They had faked it and made it look like, you know, sugar, you know, little flowers of sugar. Oh. And they had made it with mud. And, you know, amazing. This is creativity. I am very unimpressed by chefs who go to culinary school, who sit, who are in huge stainless steel empires in big hotels, and they come up with dishes. Yeah. It's impressive. It's very good. Well done. But those two girls in Jaipur were dreaming of making that cake for real. They took mud, they used color, holy colors, and they made, they colored the mud, and they made it look like sugar icing and little roses, and they even made a candle for me. And you know, you it just kind of, if you ever, you know, it is exhausting, you know, to keep giving and giving and giving. There are times when I know I'm running on empty. I know I'm drained, I know I'm hollow inside. And then I think of all of this, and I think, you know, no, you've got to do it. You've got to keep pushing. You know, every day is a gift to me. Every day I wake up, I thank God I'm alive. But I also know I have one day less to live. And I'm not willing to die. I'm not willing to end my life till I've made enough of a difference so that I leave the ripples after me. I want to be that person that people, long after I'm gone, know that there was this woman who had an all-female kitchen. There was a woman who stood by other women. And that's the legacy I want to leave. I want to inspire the next generation of people to know that, you know, a lot of people tell me that, you know, oh, you're the first in Netflix. You broke the glass ceiling. I don't want to break the glass ceiling. I want to bring the entire edifice down. I don't want to bring down the ceiling. I don't want to be the only one. I want the space to be free for every woman who looks like me, who sounds like me, everyone who has been rejected and made to feel that they didn't count, who was mocked for the way they looked or the size of their body. Every woman who felt othered by others, I want that whole space for us. Because this is how we'll all win. You know, this is not a race where, you know, you have one person only winning. It's so lonely if I'm the only person who wins. I want to see people go ahead of me. And every time I hit a hurdle, I get around it. But then I feel glad I moved that hurdle for the person coming after me. She will not even see it. That generation of girls who are going to come after me from traditional families, from Nawab families, from Muslim families like mine, they will have someone like me. When I wanted to do this, there was nobody I could even name that I want to be like whatever. No, there was no whatever. Today, I want to be that person that every girl can use as an example, not just in cooking, but in every kind of any field that you want to be creative. I want this to be there as an example that, you know, you can follow your dreams. There is honor in being who you are. You don't need to live the life that others decided you would live. They put you in a box, the smart one who did the PhD and would be a lawyer. No, I broke out of that box. I created my own destiny.
Yes, absolutely. And so we have a question from one of our members, Inu Bala. Would you like to ask your question?
Yes, Asma, it is really empowering to listen to you. So like you said, I don't want to be remembered as a chef. I want women to come to my grave and say, she changed my life. And that's what matters.
Yes.
You've been so strong for womanhood. Have you faced discrimination, hostility, and what are the initiatives you are taking to promote women?
So that's a very good question. And yes, that is my quote, that I want women to come to my grave and say, I changed their lives. I have personally not saved discrimination, but that's because I'm the boss here. Mm-hmm. And I'm very lucky.
Yep.
And also, you know, one of the big problems that women are having in hospitality is huge amount of bullying, harassment, racism, not being promoted, being mocked for being weak, being mocked for not being strong enough. All this happens in an environment where you are outnumbered, where the men are there. Let any man touch me now, he will not be standing. He will not stand for a long time. So I will not, and that's the sad thing, that no man will take me on. They take on the weak, the vulnerable, the playground bully. Will the playground mm-hmm. bully take on Muhammad Ali? They would never have done that. They know they'll be plastered. This is the sad thing that, you know, so I have luckily not faced any of this discrimination. And I'm very conscious of that being a very privileged position that I have not. But I take this as a weapon to fight for others who are facing this every day. Just because I didn't go through it, I don't want all the hurdles that they are jumping. Other people don't see them, but I can see it. You know, even if my daughter had wanted to be a chef a few years ago, I would have said no, because I've seen horrible Gordon Ramsay shouting and screaming at people on TV. I would have said, no, Beba, don't go. Please be a doctor. Please be a lawyer. I'm a very Indian mother. I would have done that. But I have a different attitude. But, you know, it doesn't help that on the media, the people who are portrayed are aggressive. And this, and that's their rude behavior is celebrated in hospitality. So it's a real problem. So I'm not faced. It doesn't mean I will not face it in the future. But, I mean, whoever thinks that they can come forward and step all over me is dreaming, because I would not let that, not because just for myself, because so that they never ever think of doing that to another woman. Do not push us aside. We need to, and I fight not for myself, I'm fighting every day for those silent women, you know, who will never get the chance to come on stage. I'm very conscious, I'm on stage, the spotlight's on me, you know, the world knows who I am, everybody wants to talk to me. But I stand there, what I see is those silent women at the back who will never get their moment on stage. I talk for them, I speak for them, I fight for them. So even if I have not faced the bullying and the discrimination, I'm very, very conscious of the fact that it happens everywhere.
Excellent.
Asma, one last question before we conclude. Why have you named your restaurant Darjeeling Express? Again, from our members, this is a member question.
Okay, so yes, it is the toy train, huh? From New Jalpaiguri, it goes to Kersiong, where my family home is. I never named my restaurant this, nor did I name my business this. I registered a business, which was a food business, on the company's house the day I passed my PhD viva. For me, this was liberation, because I had become a doctor. And this was the important thing, that I had become a doctor, and I wouldn't have to hear this from everybody else, that, she never finished her PhD. So I thought, no, I want to be the person who finished the PhD. But then I had not expected them to ask me company name of company. I thought, just food company chalega, nahi chalega. You have to give a name. At that time, suddenly I remembered, you know, that feeling of exhilaration, of leaving the humidity of Calcutta and going into the mountains. And that freedom. And, you know, that in the train, if you call your name out, the mountain calls back your name. So, you know, the mountain echoes your name. As a child, I used to love it. I used to feel like the whole world will know me. I'll become so important. They're all calling my name. I'm very famous. When I was a child, I used to feel that. So I don't know. I thought, this is my Darjeeling Express moment of exhilaration, of freedom, of being, you know, of the mountains echoing my name. Everybody will know who Asma Khan is. So I named the Darjeeling Express. So then, of course, you can't change it after that. And, you know, I was known as Darjeeling Express. And that name has stayed. And thank God people don't. In the beginning, people said, you serve tea. And I said, no, I don't serve Darjeeling tea. But Because, you know, obviously people, some people, you know, everybody knows Darjeeling is a tea place, but I'm not a tea shop, nor do I sell Darjeeling tea. Although I should, because I have a cousin who has an estate and does Darjeeling tea, but I don't. And yeah, so that's the name.
It has a lot of character to it for sure. So thank you so much, Asma. And I'm now going to ask my Vice President, Ms. Sumita Roy, to say a few words to you. Sumita Di, can you join us? She's on mute. She has to unmute herself.
I must say, I'm very impressed by the Zoom connection.
Yeah.
I have done calls to LA where you think, you know, in LA they have decent Wi-Fi. They are like horrible. I keep losing people. They're going off. They're calling you on the phone. This has been so stable, the Wi-Fi.
We've had very luck on our side.
Yeah. Thanks, Asma, for sharing your journey and cooking expertise to bolster up our members of all ages with pride in your success and gastronomical delights. Thank you for giving your time and virtually ushering us into your kitchen of Darjeeling Express. Thank you. And
thank you.
We thank our members for participation and media for the support. And stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sumita Di. Thank you so much. And thank you so much, Asma. And of course, Asha and Rashmi. And we all of us are
here. Thank you. Does everybody know that you and I went to school, the same school?
Well, I was senior to you, my dear. So I don't think
you don't look it. So you don't look it. So you guys have been at school together and let everybody think you're much younger. Hey, yeah, you missed a trick. When I say you went to school together, so, we went to school together.
That's true. That's true.
Bye,
Rashmi. And also, Asma, we want to wish you on behalf of Ladies Study Group, all of you, a wonderful Eid ul-Adha, full of happiness, peace, prosperity, and good health. I think your name, Asma, means to be true to yourself. And I think it is the most important takeaway for each and every one of us today with respect to our own selves. I think food is definitely the foundation of genuine happiness. So ladies, don't be afraid of cooking and experimenting, as your ingredients will know if you are, and then they're going to misbehave. So enjoy your cooking and the food will behave and it will pass your joy and pleasure to those that you eat it with. I will be sharing Asma's specially created recipes with all of you, and I wish all of you happy cooking ahead. Stay safe and stay happy, and see you soon on our next webinar. And thank you so much again, Asma. Thank you so much. Truly means a lot.